First of all, when you look at ancient texts and traditions all over the world, literally all over the world, you find very clear descriptions of an advanced race or races that we would call extraterrestrial, not of this planet, that came to this planet and brought this advanced knowledge a long, long time ago. Some of the most famous examples of this are what have become known as the Sumerian texts or tablets. They were found in what we now call Iraq in the last century, about 1850. There's thousands of them. And they've been translated by a number of people, most famously a guy called Zecharia Sitchen. People think he's the only one that's done it because of the publicity and stuff that he's got in his books, but many other people have done it and actually have come to a slightly different interpretation than him. But the common theme of all of them is this, that a group which the Sumerian tablets, which were buried around 2000 BC, something like that, that they talk about this group they call the Anunnaki in Sumerian, those who from heaven to earth came, which is the basic translation, but those who came from the high place and down to the earth overall is the feel of it, the Anunnaki. And when it talks about these Anunnaki and the tablets and stuff, and here's an example of just one of the so-called cylinder seals that were found among them, depicting various things. There are some remarkable points and areas of text and evidence that you can see. First of all, there is remarkable knowledge in these texts of planetary, solar system, universal, astronomical knowledge that has only been confirmed in this century and sometimes even more recently. In the text, for instance, they describe what Uranus and Neptune look like in a way that's only been confirmed in literally the last few years. They depict the solar system with planets that have only been found in the last century and the 20th century. How did they do that? What they say is the knowledge was brought by this Anunnaki. But it's more than that, because it talks in some detail about how this Anunnaki interbred with humanity, creating a hybrid race. And you find this theme all over the world. You find it in Genesis, in the Bible, which is a rewrite, when you do the research, of the Sumerian stories. So we get the theme of the sons of God, who interbred with the daughters of men. But when you take that back to the Hebrew, just one step, you find that that phrase, sons of God interbred with the daughters of men, actually says sons of the gods interbred with the daughters of men. And every time in the Old Testament you see the word God, it's translated from a word meaning gods. And it's clear to me that we have been misled and we've misunderstood the difference between the gods, symbolically extraterrestrials in the ancient world, and God, which is all consciousness, all energy, everything that exists. So these Sumerian tablets very much confirm this ancient race. Now, again, when you look at other cultures, you find the same stories in the ancient Hindu cultures, the Veda. The Vedas, their ancient holy books, you find descriptions of the gods flying in flying machines, which we would call aeroplanes or UFOs or flying saucers, whatever. And when you take the common theme around the world, it's very clear that in the ancient world was a race or races of very, very high technological knowledge. And this was the knowledge that built the pyramids. This was the knowledge that built all those ancient structures which conventional history and archaeology simply cannot explain. Now, this area here of what we call the asteroid belt would seem to be very, very significant. If you take Zecharia Sitchen's translation of the Sumerian tablets, the detail of which I have a problem with, I must say, here and there, they talk about, according to his translation, that a planet called Nibiru, the planet of the crossing in his translation of the Sumerian, came into this solar system a vast amount of time ago. And one of its moons collided with a planet that was between Jupiter and Mars, and that created the asteroid belt, which just happens to be between Jupiter and Mars. That's one interpretation of what happened, but there are others, and I've come across a scientist, a friend in America, who's been researching all this for 30 years, and he is convinced from a large amount of different evidence that actually something different happened, not least because at a major corporation he used to work for, they did a study, the physicists at that corporation, into what must have happened to the solar system, because when you look at the planets and how they spin and how fast they spin and all this stuff, it's very clear that some major, major disruption has happened in this solar system. It's affected not just the Earth, but also the other planets. It's a major cataclysm. And they came to the conclusion, which basically supports the theme of a guy called Emanuel Velikovsky in the 50s, who was ridiculed for saying that what we now call Venus went through this solar system, devastated Mars, and almost destroyed the Earth. But these physicists are actually supporting the basis of that. What they believe as a result of their research is that the planet we now call Jupiter came into this solar system not that long ago, remarkably, 7,000 years ago maybe, something like that. 4,800 BC was the date that I was given for the, you know, the window of time that it happened. And it collided with a planet that was in that area, and devastation unfolded, and the asteroid belt was the result. They also suggested that a great chunk of Jupiter, which is a colossal planet, of course, broke off and careered through this solar system and devastated Mars. Interestingly, the probes to Mars have suggested that the landscape of Mars is no more than 10,000 years old, so something certainly happened there that devastated it, and came close enough to the Earth and was caught in the Earth's field for a while, did a couple of orbits, and that orbit, when you look at the scientific suggestion of what that would have caused, starts to confirm some incredible legends, traditions, and oral and written evidence from the ancient world all over the planet that there came what the Bible calls the Great Flood. One of the things that this would have done, this pass by what we now call Venus, is to have created a 10,000-foot tidal wave. Interestingly, in the pre-flood world, since then, agriculture as we know it began at heights above 10,000 feet. Quite obvious why that would have happened in the scenario we're talking about.